Lili Bernard is an Afro-Cuban artist. She's an Afro-Cuban-American artist. She speaks Spanish fluently. She is Black and Cuban. And she does a lot of work about her identity and history and the history of the slavery struggles. A lot of people don't realize that there was also slavery in Cuba. And it actually persisted longer than it persisted stateside. And so what she does is she takes well-known art historical references and transforms them through the lens of a feminist Afro-Cuban artist who has a lot to say about slavery and Black identity. But she doesn't only work in painting. So what I love about this show, and we invited Lili Bernard to show here, we're so thrilled she could do it, and unfortunately she's not here to talk to you. She would have been, but she's been ill, and so she had to cancel her engagement here today, and so I'm trying to speak on her behalf. But what you see in front of you is not one of her paintings. This is an installation which was part of a larger performance art piece. And it really had to do about African hair, bad hair, you know, that for so many decades and for such a long time, African Americans have hated their hair, have tried to make their hair look more white, straightened their hair, conked their hair, done all kinds of things. What she did with this installation is she sort of created a ritual performance where people could sort of throw off the yoke of having their hair be sort of turned white, made to be acceptable to the white majority, and they could embrace and accept their Blackness, their Black bodies, and their Black hair. And so behind us we see these posters with people sort of, these are fake promotional posters for very natural products where really you're not putting chemicals in your hair, you're simply putting oil in your hair and you're letting your hair be what it is. And so each of these three colors and these smaller tables, these are all ritual objects for this performance, which was performed at Otis Art Institute. With drummers and Orisha priests and the public. So it was quite exciting. We weren't able to do a performance here, but we at least were able to show the performance objects. If we kind of pan around the room, here we have a whole series of her paintings, and again, Lili is a trained artist and a wonderful painter. And what she does is she takes art historical paintings. So paintings that are very familiar to the public, very familiar to any art student. This one particularly is based on Manet's Olympia, where you had a sort of a reclining female. And in the spot where, in Manet's Olympia, there was a Black servant girl, she reverses the order. So instead of a white woman with a Black servant girl painted by a white European male, she takes the perspective of a Afro-Cuban feminist artist and she shows us a Black slave and the white owner who is about to rape her. Now, looking through the window, I believe what you're seeing is the wife of the white owner and the daughter. And it was sort of known that the slaves were property and the white slave owners would do whatever they wanted to their Black female slaves, and rape was common. But it was also true that women, white women, were sort of also chattel as well. They were property as well. And imagine how it must have felt to be like married to this landowner, and you have no more to say about what's going on between him and a slave woman than the slave woman herself. Not only that, but during this period of time, women, if they were nagging, annoying women, they were often outfitted with this apparatus to shut them up. So I want you to notice that both the slave woman who's about to be raped and the wife peering in through the window. Both of them have the apparatus to kind of shut them up. So all women were disempowered. All women were sort of gagged.
Ms. Paley, what can you tell me about this painting here?
So, first of all, again, Lili Bernard is making a large, heroic, famous art historical painting called The Birth of Venus, her own. She's filtering this very famous painting through the lens of sort of an Afro-Cuban feminist woman artist. And so what you're seeing here is a slave auction. This is called The Sale of Venus. So instead of the birth of Venus, Venus who comes out of the water on a shell, it's a very famous painting of Botticelli, a Renaissance painting. She has her in chains, and she's pregnant, and being poked at a slave auction. And in fact, what's really interesting here, down here, Venta de Esclavos, that you even see, this is a Cuban slave auction. All of her work is really based on very specific historical things. And so there's plenty of small and large references. This is a real slave auctioneer that she did a lot of research to know. I actually don't know as much, obviously, about all of the details as she did. But the position of the female, these gods sort of coming in from one side or from the other, they're all in the same position as this painting. So anybody looking at it would have that shock of recognition, like, oh, this is, I've seen this before, but it's different. It's really different. And it turns a celebration of beauty into this really gripping, terribly sad moment in history. So you know how I was saying how Lili likes to take art historical paintings and filter them through her lens? So this is another example. This is based on Delacroix's very famous Liberty Leading the People, where you had Liberty and it was about the French Revolution. Whereas what she does is she does Carlotta Leading the People. So Carlotta was, this was a slave uprising led by a female slave, with horrifying results afterwards. As you can see, we have some lynchings, some severed heads, but you definitely have the re-empowerment of African women and Africans or Afro-Cuban slaves being given their moment in this painting. And you see the the killed revolutionaries. Next to this painting, we have another painting based on a famous art historical painting. So here you have a painting based on, it's a famous painting by Artemisia Gentileschi. And Artemisia Gentileschi was a Renaissance painter, a woman, very unusual in the Renaissance. She herself was raped. There's a lot I could talk about, but really I want to kind of talk back about the painting. And this again is about the slave revolt, whereas in this case you have the moment when the revolt begins. This Carlotta is severing the head of her captor, her oppressor. And it's based on the tale of Judith and Holofernes. The original Artemisia Gentileschi painting had Judith, who crept into Holofernes's tent to, and there was a war between the Hebrews and, I believe, the Babylonians. My Old Testament history is not the best. But Judith and Holofernes, basically what happened was Judith seduced Holofernes. He was threatening and waging war against the Israelites. And she went into his tent. She got him drunk. Maybe she did something else. And when he was passed out in bliss, she cut off his head. So here you have a slave revolt with Carlotta cutting off the head of her oppressor.
What would you specifically call Lili's style of art, or is there a specific style that I guess maybe her art would fall into the category of?
You know, right now there are a lot of artists working in a lot of different ways. So you notice she works with installation and performance and video and painting. And in each one there seems to be a different style, and what pulls them all together is the sort of social issues she's most passionate about and interested in exposing. So it's hard to say there's a specific style. I would say that the genre that she's engaged with is really art as a social practice, art as something that gives a community an opportunity to bat around certain issues, especially with her performance, where she was sort of allowing people to sort of break the shackles of a certain way of thinking about their own bodies, their own hair. Right now, there are a lot of artists who are doing eclectic varieties of things, doing paintings, and installations, and video, and animation. And they're hard to say this is her style or this is his style. It's actually a very exciting time because artists are finally allowing themselves to not be pigeonholed, not be told, this is the kind of artist you are. Like, no, she's free to do any kind of medium she wants, to do any kind of message she wants. So I'd say eclectic social practice.